They were the biggest rap group on the planet and the most controversial. They sold millions of records preaching pro-black politics in a predominantly white country. All done through an unrelenting wall of noise that changed the sound of hip-hop.
Yo, I got something new, Public Enemy. And I was like, what the hell? Who is this?
Oh my God, this is totally new sound.
They're just played by absolutely no rules.
Yeah, boys.
Drop it!
The self-proclaimed prophets of rage who opened the eyes of a generation to the black struggle.
If you think that the noise is the music, the lyrics are even going to be noisier than the music.
No one was teaching me about black politics in school.
Come here, listen to this.
As a human being, you're like, oh yeah, that makes sense. I've never thought about it like that before.
Their militant attitude upset middle America, the media, and the government.
When I watched the video the first time, I kind of felt queasy inside, and I thought, my heavens, who would ever want to put something like this together?
There's a lot of people that don't ever want to hear a peep from the black man.
The plan was to have us self-destruct.
Friendships were stretched to breaking point. Could they hold it together long enough to get their message across?
Yo, what you gonna do, man? Seriously, because I'm fed up to hear.
If I would have shot that man in his head, I would not be sitting here talking to you guys today.
The points made, you consider it done by the prophets of rage.
What do people say?
You're quite hostile.
1970s America. Hip-hop was in its early phase, rising up from the ghettos of New York, the Bronx, Brooklyn, and Queens. The perfect environment to breed rap's most political group. But that wasn't where the Public Enemy story started. It began on the more affluent streets of New York's Long Island.
There's sort of a point of migration for African Americans who are working class or working in middle class, had kids, looking for, you know, a backyard and a safe place to raise their kids from, you know, the urban landscape that was Manhattan and Brooklyn and Queens.
Out of the gains of the civil rights movement, many African American middle class neighborhoods were created. But what happened was, estate agents knew full well that white America didn't want to live next to black people, so they'd create middle class African American neighborhoods. So even though it was middle class, everyone's black still.
We did have grass as opposed to growing up playing on the concrete, like our cousins in the Bronx and Brooklyn and Manhattan. So fresher air, but nonetheless, you know, racism was still there and we still had to deal with it.
The Public Enemy members grew up within a few square miles of each other in the small town of Roosevelt. While hip-hop was developing on the hard streets of New York, these future political firebrands were studying at their local university. Brothers Keith and Hank Shockley ran their own sound system, Spectrum City. They made their name DJing at neighborhood parties and community centers.
When rap was in its early stages, there used to be a thing where if somebody played what is known as a hip-hop beat, all right, or a traditional hip-hop record, all the MCs will line up and they want to grab the microphone.
Bricks in a bus, brakes on the car, brakes to make you a superstar.
And at that time, you would have like literally like 20 or 30 guys wanting to get their turn so that they could show their skills. Most of the guys that are rapping were horrible.
Young graphic design student Carlton Ridenhour, who called himself Chucky D, was one of the Spectrum City fans in the crowd.
I kind of wanted to get my dance on. And whenever a whack MC got on the microphone to MC the crowd, they usually would just mess it up for the crowd and a dance. So what I would do is just like get on the microphone to get them intimidated not to get on it.
He sounded clearer, more succinct. He sounded better than any of the 30 rappers that was there. And he had some wit and some intelligence to him. So I said, you know what? I needed an MC for my situation to take it to another level.
And I was like, I'm not trying to be, you know, in the middle of that mix because, I mean, I just like to go to the gigs. I dig it. He said, nah, try this with us. And I tried it after the first weekend. I did a gig with Spectrum City, and from that point on, it was a natural fit.
Mind over matter, mouth in motion, can't defy, cause I'll never be quiet. Let's start this.
Spectrum City had found their MC, and Chuck D is calling.
He
He patterned his vocal styles after Marv Albert, a Jewish brother who's one of the famous sportscasters in this country.
Part radio announcer, part stadium announcer, part Southern black preacher, part, you know, sassy, brassy New Yorker.
The speaker, the public speaker, the leader. He wasn't a preacher. He was a leader.
When you heard Chuck speak, you felt like your father was talking to you. He was telling you some real shit, you know.
If I could say I've ever had a man crush on anyone, quote unquote, it was Chuck D, you know, because it was just like, man, who is this dude?
There was a Marvel Comics character called Black Bolt. I'm a big comic fan, and Black Bolt could never speak because if he even opened his mouth and uttered the slightest tiny little sound, like, he could blow up a mountain with that. And that's what I always considered Chuck to be. Chuck was Black Bolt.
With Chuck on the mic, the Spectrum City sound system really took off, playing all over Long Island. The group members discovered they had more things in common than just music. They all grew up in the 60s and shared a passion for politics. Most kids into hip-hop were several years younger.
You have a group of people who grew up their first 10 years in the turbulent 1960s as kids. So assassinations that took place in the 60s, they stuck. I mean, I was in first, second grade. The president just got shot 5 years prior. Assassinations of Malcolm X when I was 5, Dr. Martin Luther King when I was 8. Then you had the destruction, the COINTELPRO, J. Edgar Hoover, the Black Panther Party. So coming up in the 60s made us see a different world than somebody who was maybe born in 1970 and then saw the 70s.
Within a few years, Spectrum City were the biggest DJ crew on Long Island with their own show on university radio station WBAU. They fast got a reputation for playing the hottest rap records. Picking up the station's signal in Queens, established hip-hop artists like Run DMC started paying attention.
We went to be interviewed at WBAU. I remember when we first walked in, and it was a guy sitting there eating chicken wings out of a styrofoam container, answering a telephone.
Yo, G, what's up, G? Yo, what's up, yo?
DMC had just tasted the vital ingredient that gives Public Enemy its flavor.
He's always happy, he's always, like, you know, excited.
Yeah, boy, you know, just kind of chiming in like a little brother.
He was nuts. He was like, he is now.
Personality, walks personality, talks personality, smiles.
You see that? Just the flavor, flavor.
And that excitement is infectious, it's contagious.
Throw your hands in the air.
Flavor is the dude who presents disorder.
What are you looking at? Can you see me in there?
And dissonance, spontaneity, the gift of gab, and anything goes.
Everybody thinks I'm cuckoo.
With hip-hop still in its early days, there weren't enough new records to fill up a whole radio show. So with Flavor Flav now part of the crew, Spectrum City experimented with their own music to play on the airwaves. Their early demos were an instant hit with the listeners. And it was from one of these they would take their new name, Public Enemy.
We would always go up to BAU just to hang out, because it was just a beautiful scene. But then I remember, when we went up there, like, this probably was like the 25th time, and they, you know, they played, they was playing records, and then they played Public Enemy number one.
Yo, Chuck, what's the move, man? I was on my way up here to the studio, you know what I'm saying? And this brother stopped me and asked me, yo, what's up with that brother Chucky D? He swayed
like... And he said, I'm all in, put it up on the board. Another rapper shot down from the mouth that roared.
1, 2, 3, down for the count. The beats, all of my lyrics, oh yes, no doubt. Cold rock rap, 49 is a cream. It's what I choose and I use, I never lose 20.
Me and Che, we said this, we said, we ran to Rick Rubin, yo, you gotta hear this, you gotta hear this. We said, God has come down from heaven to rock the mic.
Rick Rubin, boss of soon-to-be legendary record label Def Jam. In the mid-80s, home to two of the biggest names in rap, Run-DMC, and the Beastie Boys. Always ahead of the game, Rick was keen to sign Public Enemy as soon as possible. But there was a problem.
Rick didn't want to sign Flavor. And actually, Chuck tells a funny story, you know, that he had a hard time explaining exactly what function Flavor would perform in the context of the band.
I didn't want Flavor in the group at the beginning. Here we're trying to create the Clash, you know, with hip-hop beats, and we want to be just as important and on the cover of Melody Maker and you know, NME and all these. No! Flavor?
Nobody wanted Flavor. But they wanted me. And I said, well, if you're going to get me, you got to take out Posse.
Chuck D forced Flavor Flav down Def Jam's throat.
Oh, Chuck, they out to get us, man. Yo, we got the Dutch boys on.
Chuck and the group signed to Def Jam in 1986, quickly recording their debut album, Yo, Bum Rush the Show. But due to the label's release schedule, the record didn't hit the stores until the following year. Hip-hop was moving so fast, rapping and production techniques were changing all the time. When the album finally came out, it was already sounding outdated. Then to make matters worse, Eric B. and Rakim blew everybody away with a slick new style.
Eric B. and Rakim came out with, you know, their epic single, Eric B. is President and I Know You Got Soul. And that record, that was a game changer.
I'm experiment like a scientist. You want to rhyme? You got to sign my list. Because I'm a manifest and bless the mic I hold. You want an X? Then you got to have soul.
It just changed the whole terrain of rap, how you're supposed to rap, this style that you're coming with, this the musical style. And I was like, ah.
All of a sudden, it wasn't about drum machines anymore. It was going to be about sampling, and it was going to be about sampling some atomic funk. Despite themselves, they were lost in admiration, is really what it was. And they said, well, this changes everything. They understood as soon as that record came out, everything they'd cut till that time was outmoded.
We were happy for hip-hop, but mad that we were in the middle with an outdated, you know, record that meant something else. But we said we gotta have a record that just dominates the streets.
They could have put their heads down. They could have given up. They didn't do any of that. They went back to the studio and they started to make the best records of their career.
Yes, the rhythm's a rebel. Without a pause, I'm lowering my level. The hard rhyme, where you never been, I'm in. You want styling?
Public Enemy had completely broken away from traditional hip-hop production. Gone were the conventional rhythm tracks, replaced by a jarring wall of noise.
Rebel Without a Pause came out the summer of 1987. I will never forget it. And what caught me was the siren sound of that record.
Radio, suckers never play me. All the mix, they just don't hear me now. Knowing it grow, when the clock in my zone is no sneaking and taking everything now the brother owns.
The noise, I mean... Okay, it wasn't no noise like that in music. This is like noise with a character. Like that teapot thing or whatever that thing's in the back.
From a rebel, it's final. A black final soul. Rock and roll coming like a rhino. Tables turn, suckers burn to learn. They can't disable the power of my label.
It was innovative. It was creative. It was experimental. But above all things, it was loud.
That record ripped through the Bronx, ripped through Brooklyn, ripped through Upper Manhattan, ripped through Queens.
We said, look, if we died tomorrow, this record here is our signature. If we died tomorrow, this is it. No looking back. That was a relief.
How low can you go? Death row.
Rebel Without a Pause became the blueprint for the Public Enemy sound. The group tried out their new material on the 1987 Def Jam European Tour. The first gig was London, England.
It was like a spaceship landing. One minute they were making records, we heard, you know, the first single, second single, stuff they were doing. Next minute they were at Hammersmith Odeon in the UK, and everybody from the UK seen with it.
It all kind of built this atmosphere that something dangerous and exciting was going to happen, and this was going to be a big show.
Come on, here we go again. Turn it up. Come on, bring the noise.
We were fortunate to come out to face the hype in the UK with an intensity that matched the hype and songs that were our artillery to match the hype.
In this corner with the 98, subject of suckers, object of hate. Who's the one some think is great? I'm that one, son of a gun.
Public Enemy tore the roof off the Hammersmith Odeon. Buzzing from their European success, they returned to their Long Island studio, 510 Franklin Street, to work on their new sound. And responsible for that was their production team, the Bomb Squad. As well as Chuck, the Bomb Squad consisted of multi-instrumentalist Eric Sadler and the brothers Keith and Hank Shockley.
I started collecting records since I was five. At the time, I was like, I think I was 25 or 26. I had amassed an incredible amount of records. Doing Public Enemy and creating the album, it was more of an experiment just to see whether or not I can take snatches of recorded music and use it in a recording, creating almost an orchestra or a band with all the samples.
Add some flavor to this, man.
So here we go, y'all. Little by little, you know. We got the power and the knowledge to move them and still ride. A super song for the cause. So.
The Bomb Squad's groundbreaking production centered on the sampler, an electronic device that allowed the user to record any sound, manipulate it, then play it back. Keith, Hank, and Eric filled their individual samplers with clips of old funk records, spending hours combining the different sounds into one new groove.
Up to that point, when producers were, making rap records, you know, they would have two, three samples in a song. You know, Public Enemy would have 12 or 15 samples in a song.
We're gonna get on down now.
They would stack drum breaks on top of each other to make this entirely different clatter noise. You had no idea what record this came from. It became this brand new creation made out of found objects.
Your bad self, help us break this down from off the shelf. Here's our music serving you some music. Papa got a brand new funk.
Just, you know, reconfiguring and taking sounds and bits and placing them here and there, so forth, to create, you know, a completely new composition.
It was almost like you sat down and analyzed every single track they had. Where did they get that sample from? How did they make that sound like that? How's that DJ doing that? It was just different.
Hank Shockley gets, to me, he's like the Phil Spector of hip-hop because of his daringness to do something that's absolutely nuts at times and experiment and go for it.
They broke every rule possible, you know. If a sample wasn't gritty enough, Hank would throw the record to the ground and rub it on the floor.
Completing Public Enemy's sonic arsenal was the innovative scratching of Norman Rogers, a.k.a. DJ Terminator X, the only member of the band who spoke with his hands.
At the count of three, I want y'all to tell me the name of my DJ. One, two, three.
Terminator X, first and foremost, to me, was an ominous character. He's really tall, you know, wide guy. You could never see his eyes, because he always had them glasses on, so you never could tell what state of mind he was in.
With the X, the logo, and the glasses and all that, it's added to the whole dominance of being a DJ back there and busting out those sounds, man.
Terminator X brought to the group a style that no other DJs had.
But of course, the music of Public Enemy is only half the story. Their political fire is what drives their songs. And back in Ronald Reagan's America, there was plenty to protest about if you were young and black.
After years of civil rights gains in this country, going back to the 50s and 1960s, you saw this rollback of some things happening around voter registration, turn back of some of the civil rights policies, even things as simple as lunch programs were being cut during the 1980s Reagan era. It was the crack era. It was the explosion of crack cocaine on urban streets in America. It was something I had never seen before.
I remember being in New York, and it was like a new drug, and it just took hold massively. And there was a theory that it was kind of being allowed to happen to keep the black population down in a way, let them fight amongst themselves, bring themselves down. And then you had in Harlem, for instance, this amazing real estate, which was deliberately being allowed to be run down, not be fixed, kick them out, get the developers in. There was a lot of nasty things going on.
African Americans seemed resigned to their situation. The political activism of the civil rights movement was a distant memory.
We're 20 years past both Malcolm X and Martin Luther King. And even though there were politicians and figures who, you know, made attempts to sort of fill the shoes of those folks who came before, you know, for our generation, you know, we just didn't see anyone filling that role. So, you know, the music has sort of filled the vacuum.
One day, Hank and I was hanging a flyer with Malcolm X on the cover of the flyer of the gig that we were presenting. And this kid comes up and says, you know, who's this Malcolm the 10th? And, you know, we looked at each other and said, well, something got to be done about that. Because if this kid thinks Malcolm X is Malcolm the 10th, over the last 20 years, we've seen a dissolving of what has influenced us to be who we are.
What we continually try to do is spark the curiosity in people to learn about themselves, and also spark even a lot of kids, even of other ethnic creeds or whatever, to learn that the black man does have a culture and origin that should be respected.
Growing up as a white kid in the suburbs, like, no one was teaching me about black politics in school. You know, certainly not. You know, it's, you know, I would have no idea who Malcolm X was if it wasn't for Public Enemy records.
I mean, I've heard of Malcolm X, but I didn't know or wasn't that interested until, like, a P.E. record. Because I figured if P.E. talking about him, this dude had to be about something, you know what I mean?
I went to Catholic school all my life. They wasn't teaching me this in school. They was teaching me George Washington, cut down a cherry tree, Benjamin Franklin. But when Public Enemy started talking about historical figures, occasions, and instances, it was an education for a young brother. Fight the power!
Throughout Public Enemy's career, Chuck D said the things white America didn't want to hear. Fight the Power is one of the clearest examples. Chuck went straight for the juggler, attacking America's king of rock and roll for stealing the black man's music.
Elvis was a hero to most, but he never meant shit to me. If he's straight out racist, the sucker was simple and plain.
Motherfucking men, John Wayne.
Cause I'm black and I'm proud. Already I'm hyped plus I'm amped. Most of my heroes don't appear in no stamp.
Elvis was a hero to most, but he never meant shit to me. He was straight out racist. Like that. That was unheard of. People weren't doing that kind of name dropping like that.
What Chuck was doing was saying, you know, enough of these white heroes. We want to celebrate some other heroes as well, you know. It was shocking. It was shocking. And, you know, when people talk about Chuck D being Malcolm X, that was the kind of stuff that was Malcolm X-esque.
I got a letter from the government the other day. I opened and read it. It said they were suckers. They wanted me for their army or whatever. Picture me giving a damn. I said never. Here's a land that never.
And for their second LP, Chuck's rabble-rousing rhymes combined perfectly with the explosive Bomb Squad production to create one of pop music's all-time classic albums.
It Takes a Nation of Millions to Hold Us Back is the greatest hip-hop CD or album of all time.
They had a complete mastery of the recording studio as an instrument that no one has ever topped.
Nevertheless, they could not understand that I'm a black man and I can never be a veteran.
The politics of the time helped drive and connect perfectly with the sound.
People always say to me, well, what is it comparable to? I say it's comparable to the best work of Bob Dylan. It's comparable to Miles Davis's Kind of Blue. It's comparable to Love Supreme by John Coltrane. It's the Beatles' White Album.
Listen, I see it on their faces.
First come, first serve basis.
Standing on line, checking the time. Homeboys playing the curve, the same ones they used to do early.
I was mesmerized by it, you know, and I tell everyone who wants to understand hip-hop, no matter what era you're from, you've got to listen to Nation of Millions from top to bottom, because from there you can see the strands that created N.W.A. and Dr. Dre. You can see the strands that created Timbaland and Missy Elliott. You can see the strands that created Kanye West and Eminem and all these other folks. It's all there.
Succotash is a meal for kids that make cash, selling drugs to the brother man instead of the other man.
Brother than sister.
I'm talking about
me. It Takes a Nation of Millions sold 500,000 copies in its first month of release. And if you were going to drop pro-black politics on a large audience in 1980s America, you needed some muscle backing you up.
Griff, Mr. Martial Artist.
Griff had this tiny dynamo kind of vibe to him. He was the big thing in the small package.
Brother in the Red Beret goes by the name of Professor Griff.
This other guy who was kind of so militant that even someone like Chuck was like, Puff, you gotta calm down a bit.
You got this little guy and four guys on stage doing karate movements, marching in unison.
They're called the security of the first world. Why? Because we believe that black people are first world people.
When I first seen these two guys come out doing these choreographed military steps with these fake Uzis, you know, that looked real as I don't know what, you know what I'm saying? The crowd went crazy.
It wasn't an act. These guys were for real. It's not like they hired a bunch of background dancers. The S1Ws were really the S1Ws. And they were on the tour bus, you know, doing hundreds of push-ups every day. Like, you didn't fuck with those guys.
I was at the Hollywood Palladium watching the Public Enemy show one time, and a guy jumped on stage and looked like he wanted to do something to Flav. He was running towards Flav, but he had this crazed look on his face. And I saw Griff grab the guy with one hand, a certain part of his arm, turn a certain way. And in the third move, this guy was locked up in a certain way, and Griff was throwing him back in the audience, jumping down there with him. It went the S1s, and they all escorted this guy out the place. The concert continues.
We never start any trouble. We don't boast to be badasses or anything like that. It's just that if something come our way in a situation, fighting is the last resort. That's what we was taught. But if your back is against the wall and there's only one way out, you have to do what you got to do to get out.
The S1Ws were shocking, but what I liked about it was it showed togetherness, it showed unity.
That's what the whole thing was in my eyes. These guys are here to defend what Chuck is saying. It was like, yeah, I said it. And what? And what?
That serious, no-nonsense kind of demeanor, it was very needed. Number one, to show young black men that, you know, we could be disciplined, clean, respectful, articulate, not disrespecting women, not spewing the madness, not doing all of the things that I guess the stereotypical image of black men. We don't have to do those things.
Professor Griff wasn't just the hired heavy. A passionate believer in black power and the Nation of Islam, he was made Public Enemy's Minister of Information. It was his role to research political content for Chuck's lyrics and handle the press. He was also the group's tour manager, and that meant making sure the man with a big clock around his neck was on time for gigs.
It's gonna be bedlam the weekend.
Take his car, nowhere to fly.
Public Enemy had a kind of built-in instability. You've got Flavor and Griff in the same band. It made no sense. It's never made any sense. And the fact that they managed to do anything together with these two guys, these two polar opposite character types in the same band,
completely miraculous.
I've never smoked, never took a drink. I wasn't the party type, straight lace, so to speak. It's gonna be Bentham, the queen ghetto. So now I'm meeting this dude who's Chuck's friend, who's stealing cars, selling drugs, doing all this kind of stuff, and then now I have to partner up with this guy and manage that?
Yo, man, we was in this shop. Terminator showed me these things. I said, well, I'm going to get them when I got them.
The dude never owned a set of luggage. He had plastic bags with his clothes and deodorant and toothbrush and socks and underwear in, like about 15 bags.
Like Griff, Chuck and the S1Ws didn't smoke, drink, or do drugs. By the time Nation of Millions hit the charts, Flavor Flav was into all of them.
Tonight is the night Flavor's gonna fuck up because I'm fucked up. You know what I'm saying? Flavor fucked up, you know what I'm saying?
Oh, what kind of example are you to young black men that we're trying to set an example for? You're doing everything opposite of what we're trying to do. We're trying to save our people, but we got to drag you out of the crack house.
Anytime that I ever got with my group, I was always functional. I've never was a dysfunctional addict or dysfunctional addict.
Come on, Rico. I didn't do nothing.
No, you are doing something just as you speak, because you got those dark glasses on. You spilling orange juice all on me because it's all over you. You're wrong again.
The only thing that I say that drugs did to me was it made me miss some of my shows.
There were shows where, you know, one of the S1s, you know, had to don Flavor's clothing and put the glasses on and put the clock on.
So we tried to pull it off with just dressing up someone else as Flavor, and some guy in the front row was like this. That ain't Flavor! They blew the cover off of everything, man, and we had to confess. It was embarrassing. It was really embarrassing, man.
Let me hear you say, oh!
He may have driven Griff crazy, but Flavor Flav was an essential part of Public Enemy.
I didn't think Chuck would have ever gotten across without Flavor.
Because the message was such a strong message and powerful, he kind of like offshot that with the humorous side.
I want to do my dance, man. Can I do my dance?
Yeah, do your dance. Go ahead.
Yo, I ain't got nothing to do.
Terminate X, give him a beat, let him do his goddamn dance.
He was always like the outcast of the outcast. Once you're the outcast of the outcast, then how do you actually fit yourself into the world? You really don't. You kind of like have the world spin around yourself. That's Flavor Flav. And I salute him and respect him for his free-minded self, although it has to be tapered when it comes down to a team.
The group was a real clash of characters, but somehow it worked. Record sales climbed into their millions. They performed alongside established acts like LL Cool J, Run DMC, and Jazzy Jeff and the Fresh Prince. Their success gave them a platform to preach their politics to a large audience of both blacks and whites.
Everybody say, fuck the racist! No. Y'all gotta say it with some attitude. Say, fuck the racist!
We brought racism, white supremacy, and we put it right in the face of white people and say, this is what we had to deal with all our lives. Here's a mirror. Check this out. Oh, okay, I understand. So now the dialogue is started.
But their detractors countered it was Public Enemy who were racist, inciting hatred rather than promoting equality.
I consider this motherfucker guilty. I'm gonna ask y'all, is he guilty?
Somebody's gonna come out and say, I'm separatist. You know, it's absolutely crazy because what rap is doing is bringing everybody together. That's why you hear the bad news about rap. I mean, this only comes from a white supremacist viewpoint that they don't want to see blacks and whites mixed together.
Public Enemy, in their music, kind of rebel-rousing.
Some record stores and radio shows banned their music. The group captured the mood on the track Incident at 66.6 FM, which sampled real-life listeners on a radio phone-in.
get some Cosby a little very upset by the things you're saying. It's on the air. Hello.
Yes, hello.
Yes.
I've seen these guys. I saw them warm up for the Beastie Boys last year.
How were they?
How were they? I thought it was one of the most appalling things I have ever seen. There were two gentlemen in cages on either side of the stage with fake Uzis. There were, Jesus, it was unbelievable.
What was pissing off parents more than anything in suburbia in the late 80s was, you know, black music.
Now, you may never have heard of some of these stars, but your kids have. They're heroes to a whole new generation.
Don't believe the hype! Don't believe the hype!
When little Johnny took the Public Enemy poster home and put it up on his wall, you know Mr. and Mrs. White America got very angry. In other words, like, Johnny, who are these black guys you have on the wall here? Carrying guns and all this kind of stuff, man, talking about black power.
The problem with Public Enemy was not just that they were educating black people about the racist power structure within which they live. It's that they were educating white people that in many cases had been socialized into a racist structure, sometimes without even knowing it. And then this guy comes out from Long Island and says, hold on a minute, have you thought about this, this and this? And you're like, as a human being, you're like, oh yeah, that makes sense. I've never thought about it like that before.
But all the attention only made them more popular. Having conquered the charts, it seemed a natural progression to move into the movies. Spike Lee was an up-and-coming film director known for his thought-provoking films on black culture. In 1989, he asked the group to write a song for his controversial new movie, Do the Right Thing. Set in a blistering New York summer, it tackled racial tension in Brooklyn. Chuck and the Bomb Squad wrote the song Fight the Power for the soundtrack. Spike made it the film's recurring theme.
A lot of youth in inner cities were facing the similar issues, and that's why it was so popular and so impactful to us, because it was a form of, even if it was just a false sense of empowerment, it was still something that we had to call our own and that could articulate how we felt.
Fight the power! Fight the power! We got to fight the power.
You have this song, Fight the Power, that has this driving beat sampling James Brown, you know, and there's two scenes that stand out for me. One is the opening scene where you see Rosie Perez dancing very aggressively to it, you know. And then the second thing is this Radio Raheem with his big radio, because that's what we carried back in the day, these huge radios. I had one myself, and you would put your cassette in there, and you would just play the records over, the songs over and over again. And, you know, what was really deep is when the radio got destroyed near the end of the film, because it's almost like they were attempting to silence the community, and the song represented the voice of the community.
Do the Right Thing was a box office smash and was nominated for an Oscar. In the late 80s, it seemed you couldn't escape Public Enemy. The accompanying music videos cemented their position as the Black Panthers of pop. To the outsider, the group's rise to the top appeared flawless. But on the inside, it was a different story. Flavor's drug-taking affected his reliability. Confrontations with ex-military man and tour manager Professor Griff were inevitable.
Kind of found him and told him to be on time, and he had a thing about, you know, being on Flavor time is what we call it. And then he showed up late. And then Griff just kind of like snapped.
People were late. They didn't have their clothes ready. And so I'm saying, do you forget your purpose why we're here? The main purpose why we're here is to do a show. And for them to be late for a gig, that's, come on, that's tacky. That's not business-like at all.
The story goes Griff attacked Flavor, and in Flav's recent autobiography, he claims the assault left him with broken bones.
I didn't break that man's ribs like that. I punched the radio and the clock, like destroying those things, thinking that maybe this will get through to him.
I had a feeling he would probably be surprised of what he read inside my book, you know what I'm saying? Because these are things that he didn't know that was on my mind.
Only thing you can remember about me is I beat you up? You don't remember the fucking people that wanted to beat you up and me and the S1Ws protecting you and coming to your aid while you high and drunk.
Griff doesn't live inside my body, so he's not gonna feel what I feel. He's on the other end of it.
Angry and upset, Flavor Flav claims he turned up to the studio with a loaded gun.
I was about to put his lights out. And if I would have put his lights out, if I would have shot that man in his head, I would not be sitting here talking to you guys today. And I thank God for giving me the strength not to kill Griff.
Bad relations between Flav and Griff were a continuing problem. But in 1989, things got a whole lot worse. In May, the Washington Times sent journalist David Mills to interview Professor Griff. A number of topics were discussed, but when the article was published, all the attention focused on one sentence. Griff reportedly told Mills, "Jews are responsible for the majority of wickedness that goes on across the globe." With the media scrutinizing their every move, it was a PR disaster. The resulting fallout threatened to end Public Enemy's career.
At the height of your success, everything is going right. That happens, then everything just...
I just know when I read about it, I was like, what? And he said that, and now the power that the... Now he has to lead a group. And what happened? Like, I was very confused.
The Griff situation was, to me, I'm gonna be straight, was a selfish call at that time, because whether that's his belief or whatever he wanted to believe, I'm not gonna get into that, it affected everybody else. You know, I get associated with that.
I think that the thing that hurt us was, once again, was the fact that we're being seen as being haters when we were not the case at all. And I think that the incident with the Jews was something that, to me, was irresponsible.
The group was already controversial enough doing what Chuck was doing. They already had enough on their plate with Chuck speaking so directly out against the racist white power structure, without them then making irrational statements that they couldn't even intellectually defend.
It wasn't the first time Griff had brought up contentious issues in the press. The band often discussed ideas about how to regain a consciousness for African Americans, and this often spilled over into the black community's relationship with other ethnic groups. But this quote was indefensible. Did he really say those words, or were they taken out of context?
The way it was kind of put out there was definitely not my sentiment. Never had this hatred for Jewish people. Never had this hatred for white people like they say. Hell, you could take bits and pieces of this conversation we're having right now and cut it up and make it seem like I hate some damn body. My temperament and my aggressive way I talk and the passion that you see coming from me. You understand what I'm saying? Hell, we can do that all day long in the editing room. I just finished reading The Secret Relationship Between Blacks and Jews, which was given to me by somebody in Public Enemy. This conversation was going on all the time about the control and who owns these companies and, you know, why all this group of people always doing this and controlling that and having this kind of influence. And that talk went on all the time, every day. And that bit of information that I put in that particular interview with David Mills was given to me by somebody in the group. But why am I taking the heat for it?
Public Enemy's Jewish publicist Bill Adler remembers things differently.
I had a conversation with him, and it was kind of surreal in a way, because he told me he got a lot of the ideas from a book that had been published by the Nation of Islam called The Secret Relationship Between Blacks and Jews, and it's a big, thick book. And he starts quoting Henry Ford, the American industrialist, on the subject of Jews. And I said, Griff, you know, I grew up in Detroit. Henry Ford was a notorious racist, in addition to being an anti-Semite. And I said, he would have as readily and as happily upholstered the seats of his cars with your black hide as with my Jewish hide, just so you know. He said, Bill, I can't help it. It's in the book. So at that point, I understood that, you know, he accepted these ideas as a matter of faith.
Whether Griff's words were reported correctly or not, the resulting media storm required swift action from the band's leader, Chuck D.
I remember being around at that time, you know, and how tough that decision was for Chuck. It was difficult. I mean, think about it. They were the biggest rap group and one of the biggest pop groups in the world at that time, and you're told you got to get rid of one of your best friends out of the band because of his anti-Semitism. That's a lot of weight.
He felt torn between his loyalty to his old friend, Professor Griff, and his rejection of Griff's ideas.
Nobody wants to go around being called anti-Semitic, because I think it's a game that the press likes to also play, because you have to find the reasons why each and every black person associated with Public Enemy is anti-Semitic. And so it's something that they could play with and make fun out of and just keep on building up, because they find it interesting to sell papers or TV programs. But as far as Public Enemy is concerned, that's a ridiculous statement.
It was a total mess. It was a mess with me not just getting into it and handling it after it was said and done. And I just let it go. I said, you know what? Boys will be boys, and let's, you know, men will be men. Let's just, you know, it'll wash away. Did not wash away.
Def Jam's publicist Bill Adler refused to work with the group, and criticism from the world's media continued to build. Public Enemy's mission to change the consciousness of a generation was about to be wrecked by one interview. Chuck had to act to save his group. He released a statement, apologized, and sacked Griff.
Did I get thrown under the bus by organizations, by people in the group? Yeah, I did. Did it have to happen that way? No.
How do you rebuild from that? There's inside problems, is this and that. And that was the key of everything just going sour.
Most bands would have buckled under the strain, but Chuck responded to the Griff situation with typical style, head on. In their next album, standout track, Welcome to the Terror Dome, Chuck vented his anger, reigniting the whole argument.
Public Enemy didn't come to mainstream attention until recently, when one member of the group made explicitly anti-Semitic remarks. There was a furor, the group apologized. But then, in their latest rap, these words.
Crucifixion ain't no fixin'. So-called chosen, frozen, apology made to whoever pleases. Still, you got me like Jesus.
Released in 1990, Fear of a Black Planet continued the political rage of their previous album.
I can't walk in the park just because I'm dark. Boys are blue and it crews, sweating me and I'm through with the crap.
As well as preaching the teachings of black nationalists, they also tackled many social issues that affected African-American communities. Like the treatment of blacks by the police in Anti-Nigger Machine. Emergency call response times in 911 is a joke.
Now I dialed 911 a long time ago. Don't you see how late they're reacting? They only come and they come when they wanna. So get them.
And the stereotyping of black people in the movies on the track Burn Hollywood Burn.
Check out a movie, but it'll take a black one to move me.
If Def Jam were worried about the Griff scandal's effect, they needn't have been. Fear of a Black Planet was a top 10 album on both sides of the Atlantic. Public Enemy were more popular than ever. The group went on tour with big name artists like U2. They even had a presence in the Hollywood blockbuster Terminator 2. Lead character John Connor wore their t-shirt throughout the movie. They further crossed over to rock fans with their fourth hit album in a row, Apocalypse 91, The Empire Strikes Back. It featured a new version of Bring the Noise with thrash band Anthrax. Rap metal was born.
They'll never care for the brothers and sisters right across the country as a soap of the war. We got to get them straight. Come on now. They're gonna have to wait till we get it right.
Chuck still refused to rein in his political preaching. The album also included a track which caused another media outcry.
In Arizona today, another march on the state capitol. Another call for a state holiday to honor Martin Luther King Jr.
People were asking for a holiday in the United States for Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. It would be the first black person to have a holiday named after him. And you had two states that said no, New Hampshire and the state of Arizona. And I decided to get busy in writing a song about what I felt and how I just thought it was a bunch of crap that this state would just avoid the issue. Basically, we move on the state of Arizona and politicians on a fictional racist governor who got all these things going on, and at the end, we kind of blow up the spot.
The video ends with the murder of three fictitious Arizona officials. One is poisoned, another shot, and finally, the governor is blown up.
They said the video was so controversial, the nerve of rappers, you know, taking on a government official.
MTV agreed and promptly banned the video.
When I watched the video the first time, I kind of felt queasy inside, and I thought, my heavens, who would ever want to put something like this together?
That sends a clear message that the way to fight violence is with violence.
Is that what you were trying to do?
Well, Forrest, there's a lot of reaction from a lot of people, and I think the purpose of rap music or any kind of music that I feel is to raise dialogue.
It was clear Chuck had lost none of his political drive. But as the 90s rolled on, the group lost their momentum. Griff was long gone. The Bomb Squad were working on other projects. Flavor's personal demon saw him regularly in jail. And by the time Public Enemy's fifth album came out in 1994, hip-hop was changing too.
I started noticing in 91, 92, wait a minute, they're showing a lot more videos that are not the kind of substantive stuff that Public Enemy and other groups were doing.
It's like this and like that and like this and it's like that and like this and like that and
the corporation seized it by the throat and threw it down the tubes of like gangster became marketable. It became contrived.
And now it's all about bitches and hoes and how much money you got and flossing and blinging and spinning rims. And the whole materialistic kind of vibe.
I'm not a conspiratorial theorist, but I definitely believe that someone said enough of this Public Enemy stuff. These guys have got to go, you know what I mean? In whatever form that means. And, you know, eventually they were off the radio.
I would argue that, you know, the representations in the 80s were, you know, progressive compared to the average image I'm seeing of black people on TV today. And we don't even talk about it anymore. It's like, we just accept it, you know? The only place you really see black people on television is MTV. And what are they doing? Shaking their backside, telling you how much money they got.
It would take film director Spike Lee to get Public Enemy back on form. Writing the soundtrack to his 1998 film, He Got Game, the band turned in their strongest material in years.
If man is the father, the sun is the center of the earth, in the middle of the universe, then why is this verse coming six times rehearsed? Don't freestyle much, but I write them like...
After nearly 8 years out of the group, He Got Game signaled the return of Professor Griff. But it would be Public Enemy's last album for Def Jam Records. Terminator X quit the following year, leaving the music industry behind to run an ostrich farm in North Carolina. Since then, Public Enemy have taken their career into their own hands. They were one of the first bands to release an internet-only album in 1999. And from 2005 onwards, they put out records on their own label, Slam Jams. Their latest material proves they've lost none of the fire that fueled the early days.
Yeah, doing the right thing. We ain't just said just about anything just to get those out there material.
Perhaps the strangest development is Flavor Flav's recent career as a star of reality TV.
It's called The Flavor of Love. I put 20 girls in my crib, and I dated them all, trying to find the right one for your man.
Fans tuned into Flavor of Love in their millions. The show boasted the highest viewing figures in VH1's history. But it's a long way off the original message of Public Enemy.
I don't think in no shape, form, or fashion, Flavor New and Flavor of Love tarnishes or puts a blemish on what P.E. represents. It can't. It's two complete different things.
You're not seeing the real Flavor Flav. You're seeing the character that he's playing to have a TV career, and why the hell not?
I want to have a little party, you know what I'm saying? So listen.
Let's be truthful. Even on those reality shows, Flavor wasn't the fool. It was all those women around. He was just the bait to get them fools there.
Why wouldn't a reality show be up Flavor's alley? Flavor Flav was made to be seen. He is seriously the symbol of reality TV, whether I think reality TV is good or bad. Do I dig everything he does? Well, I don't dig everything anybody does. I'm my own man.
I wasn't surprised by the reality shows, but I was saddened by it because he's actually older than Chuck. And to see him reduced to basically kind of this pimp-like figure with all these women, and given the history of Public Enemy, it was sad, man. It was sad watching that, but I knew that Flavor needed money.
I'm like, come on, Flavor? Nah, bro. We didn't come all this way and do all that we've done to leave that kind of legacy, man. Now, young kids, my daughter's age, have to look through the lens of VH1
to find out what Public Enemy was about? And all they seeing is you pimping on TV? Pimping, dude? Come the fuck on, dude. Is that how we gonna leave this legacy?
I never respond to the criticisms ever. I just let people say what they say and I keep going. You know what I'm saying? It's like bumper cars, man. The shit bumps off of me, bounces off of me, and goes to somebody else, bounces off of them and goes to somebody else. I never cared. You know what I'm saying? I'm gonna tell you something. The only one that can judge me is God. No other man can judge me. So fuck what another man has to say about me.
Rolling stones of the rap game, not bragging. Lips bigger than Jagger, not sagging. It's brother backwards, I'ma leave it at that. Daddy got nothing to do with rap.
Today, Public Enemy are the Rolling Stones of the rap game. Hip-hop ambassadors touring the world playing their extensive back catalogue with a full live band. And despite all the controversy and all the arguments, the original members remain friends and still perform together.
If it's I instead of we believe in TV, screaming gangster 20 years later, of course endorsed while consciousness faded. New generation believe in them fables, gangster boogie on two turntables.
Getting close to 30 years as a group, and you could count maybe on two hands the amount of bands that last 30 years as a continuing working band, making records, touring the world, you know, at the level that they're doing it at. And so, you know, the legacy is kind of untouchable.
So it's time to leave you a preview so you too can review what we do. If you don't stand for something, you fall for anything. Harder than you think is a beautiful thing.
I don't think we would have had a black president if it hadn't been for groups like Public Enemy, because they kind of politicized a whole generation in America.
Did a generation of young whites vote for him? Because they were brought up on hip hop. Did we have something to do with that? Of course we did.
The legend of Chuck D and Flav and Griff and Terminator will live forever.
They were the most influential hip hop group in the world, without question. One of the greatest musical entities in history is Public Enemy. You don't believe me? Go listen to the records.
It's enough of record jacket madness to put my brothers and sisters on a deathbed. You know he cheated, took what he wanted, and then you bought it. Sucking up to the devil, stepping down a level. It's who they fear is you. Who protects us from us and you from you? Yes, and it counts. Fuck the 40 ounce. I sued those bastards, yeah, they got bounced. I did them like a demo, threw them out the window. I took a 98 cause I never liked the limo. But pump, 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 pump it up. A mad grind, so mad time. That's what's up, some ain't gonna change. I got them in the range, I gotta rearrange. So I'm building back your brain. Wrecking records with focus stuff. Am I loud enough? Yeah. You got to give it up.
Give it up, give it up, give it up, yo. Give it up, give it up, gotta give it up. Give it up, give it up, give it up, yeah.
And you can read producer James Hale's blog post about making this program on the BBC website. Next this evening, time for some hip-hop.